Dr. G.S. Sodhi sir has earned his PhD degree from Delhi University.
And at present, he is professor, associate professor in chemistry and forensic science at the SGDB Khalsa College, Delhi University. He has published 100 research papers and filed 10 Indian patents. He was visiting fellow National Crime Records Bureau, Ministry of Home Affairs, New Delhi, during 1996 to 97. He has successfully completed 10 research projects sanctioned by the University Grant Commission, Department of Science and Technology, Indian National Science Academy, and the University of Delhi. He received the Union Home Minister Award, National Technology Day Award, National Search for Innovation Award, Lockheed Martin India Innovation Award and India Innovation Initiative Award for innovative work in forensic science. His book entitled Indian Civilization and the Science of Fingerprinting was published by the Publication Division, Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, Government of India in 2013. He is a member of National International Fingerprint Research Group, Jerusalem. He has organized several symposia and training courses in forensic science for students, teachers, army officers, and Indian and overseas police personnel. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us today for the expert talk, and I wish you a very happy Teacher's Day. Over to you. Thank you,
Vanshika, for your kind greetings, and thanks, everyone, for inviting me over here. I'm really grateful to Dr. Ranjit. He's an old friend, and he has given me the honor to address you all. And I hope I'll stand up to his mark. And I'd like to share my screen first.
Sure, sir.
Thank you so much. I'll proceed, Dr. Ranjit. Thank you so much once again. And thanks to all the participants for giving me this chance. The topic is Advances in Chemical Development of Latent Fingerprints. And as Vanshika has told you, I'm basically a chemistry teacher. And once again, I thank all of you for giving me a happy Teacher's Day. But you know, we have extended the applications of chemistry to this very important field of fingerprints. Basically, you know, this is the fingerprint. This fingerprint evidence is considered to be the most important evidence. It's the most infallible means of identification. And it's based on the premise that no two persons and no two fingers of the same person have got identical designs on their fingertips. And that's why, as I said, in crime detection or even for peaceful purposes, this is one of the most infallible means of identification. Rather, I would say that this is the most infallible means of identification. My interest lies not only on the chemistry of fingerprints, being a teacher of chemistry, but also in the history of fingerprints. Maybe many of you are aware that the world's first fingerprint bureau was established in India, in Kolkata, which is now called Kolkata. And it was housed in Reuters building. It's still there, and the year was 1897. 7 years later, Scotland Yard established its fingerprint bureau. That was the world's second fingerprint bureau. There was a gap of almost 7 years. And they actually copied us. They are exactly on the same lines. And it was in this bureau that the classification system of the fingerprints were worked out. It was at this bureau that the index card was worked out. And when I tell this to my European friends, some of them are not convinced. They say that in 1897, you were under our rule. So how can you claim that the Indians, you know, they were the pioneers of this science? But I firmly believe, and as we go further, you will also perhaps believe with me, that we knew about the science of fingerprinting before any other civilization even had an inkling of it. And I always tell them that, look, British were ruling many countries, not only India, but many countries. Why did they opt to open the fingerprint bureau here in India? Just because they knew that we were well aware of this science. If we go a little further in history, in the medieval era, you will notice that there were many rulers in our country who would sign the routine documents but put their hand mark or palm mark or fingerprints on the more important one. And here you can see the fingerprint of Emperor Shah Jahan and that of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. I have shown only two as representative, but I have got in my collection, I've got fingerprints of Aurangzeb, I've got fingerprints of Raja Brajdev of Kangra. I've got many such treaties with me where, you know, the document was important and the ruler realized that rather than signing it, let me put my fingerprint or let me put my palm print, simply because they were aware that one can individualize or one can show his or her sovereignty by putting the hand mark or by putting the fingerprint. If we go back, that was, you know, sometimes in 15th and 16th century. And if we go back still further in ancient era, now those of you who are well versed with fingerprint science, they must be knowing that there are three broad groups of fingerprint patterns: arch, whorl, and loop. And it is on this basis that fingerprint classification system was worked out. Now, in our country, there is a scripture, a religious scripture called Samudra Shastra. It was written by Samudra Rishi in 3000 BC. I repeat, 3000 BC. That means more than 5000 years ago. And that says that fingerprints have got three types of pattern. Analogous to arch, it says seep. Analogous to loops, it says shank. And analogous to whorl, it says chakra. So, you know, we knew about this science more than 5,000 years ago. And sometimes I challenge my European friends that, do you have any document to prove that you were aware of this science more than 5,000 years ago? They, nobody has been able to produce that. So that is somewhat a little bit about the history of fingerprints. But if you study it, it's a very interesting subject. And every year, everywhere you will find that the references are pertaining to India. We were the pioneers of this science. Unfortunately, you know, we have lagged behind, and my group is trying to fill up that gap. We are trying to come at par with us. My interest arose about 30 years ago when I came across a crime report pertaining to the kidnapping of a girl child. She was 7 years old, was going to her school from her home in Tennessee. She was waylaid by three or four persons and carried location by a car. Miraculously, she escaped the dungeon of the kidnappers and somehow got united with her parents, as you can see in this slide. Must be an intelligent girl. Not only was she able to free herself from the kidnappers, but she also got united with her parents. About 4 days later, the police found an abandoned vehicle in the suburb of Tennessee. They took the girl to that car and asked her whether that was the vehicle in which she was kidnapped. She replied in affirmative. She said, yes, I was taken away in the same car. But when the car was scanned, it yielded the fingerprints of three or four adults, but the fingerprint of that girl was not there. Both the police and the parents concluded that she was pointing to the wrong vehicle. She kept insisting that she was in the same car, but no one was prepared to believe her. She was too small. She did not know the registration number. She did not even know the make of the car. So the parents and the police thought that the two cars must be of the same color. That's why she is saying that I was in that car. But after a week, the kidnappers were rounded up and they confessed to using the same car which the girl had pointed out. And now arose the big question, that if the child was in the car, where had her fingerprints vanished? Now, for those of you who are from non-forensic background, let me tell you, if you see your fingertips, you will find crisscross lines, which are called finger ridges. Nature has provided them to us so that we may have a firm grip of the object we intend to hold. In their absence, a glass of water will fall out of your hands 9 out of 10 times. When you look at these ridges from a distance, they appear to be running parallel to each other. And most of them are parallel. But at certain points, there are breaks. And these breaks are called, when the parallel trend is broken, these breaks are called fingerprint correctors. For example, if you look at the left hand side, a ridge is going further, suddenly it stops. This is one character, ridge termination. Then a ridge may divide into two, it is called bifurcation. There may be a small dot or a small island, it's called a small circle, it's called island. Then a short ridge, nothing to the left, nothing to the right, it is called short independent ridge. There may be a main ridge and a curved ridge attached to it, that is called hook. Then the ridge may be divided into three, it's called trifurcation. In Samudra Shastra, it is called Trishul. Rather than going straight, the ridge may take a roundabout and then go straight. We call it lake in modern fingerprint technology. In Samudra Shastra, it's mentioned as Aksh. Aksh means an eye. Then there may be two parallel ridges joined by one small ridge that is called crossover. If you look at the right-hand side figure, then character number three is an island. Number four is ridge termination. Number five is a bifurcation. Number six is a lake. And number seven is a short ridge. So on any one finger, on an average, there are 80 to 85 characters. When we match two fingerprints, basically we see whether the same characters are located at the same place or not. And according to Indian law, if eight such characters match, then the person is same, otherwise he is not. So there are 80 characters on an average on each fingertip. But for identifying the person, we need eight only. So even if the fingerprint at the scene of crime is partial, it doesn't matter. Eight characters out of 80 can easily be identified. These ridges are studded with small holes, which you cannot see in the previous diagram. And these holes are called sweat pores. And as the name implies, sweat continuously oozes out of those holes. That means if I keep my finger on any surface, I leave behind the deposition of sweat exactly in the same pattern as is the design on my fingertips. But I cannot see that pattern because sweat is colorless. That's why we call it a latent fingerprint. Latent means a hidden fingerprint. What we can do is we can make it colored. We can visualize it. But before that, we must know what is the composition of sweat. Sweat contains 99% water. 1% inorganic ions are there. Sodium, potassium, iron, calcium, strontium, magnesium, sulfate, chloride. And 0.5%, remaining 0.5% are organic compounds, amino acids, fatty acids, proteins, carbohydrates, vitamins. So what fingerprint researchers basically do is we select any one constituent and by some physical or chemical means, we convert it into a color derivative, from a colorless to a color derivative, so that whatever is hidden, whatever was latent, that becomes visible and we say that the fingerprint has been developed or the fingerprint has been detected. Which constituent of sweat will I choose? Well, that primarily depends upon the surface, the nature of the surface, and the color of the surface. But in all, there are 5 or 6, maybe 7 standard methods which are being used all around the world for detecting fingerprints. A few of them have been innovated by us in Delhi University, in Khalsa College. But before I come to that, let me tell you about one or two known methods so that you may have a feel how fingerprints are detected. The most common and the most easy method is called powder method. Now, as chemists, we have to know what are the constituents of powder and to which constituent of sweat will the powder adhere. The powder largely adheres to the moisture content of sweat. Please appreciate moisture is present to the extent of 99% in sweat. And the powder contains two broad chemicals. One is called adhesive and the other is called colorant. Adhesive gets adhered to the moisture content of sweat. And what's an adhesive? The examples of adhesive, chalk powder is an adhesive, talcum powder is an adhesive, starch is an adhesive. It is not white in color. So if somebody takes away your notebook, the pages are also white. And white on white, without any contrast, we cannot detect the fingerprints. So you add a color to it, which will get absorbed on the adhesive. So it's a mechanism is double adsorption. The adhesive will get absorbed on the moisture content of sweat, and colorant will get adsorbed on the adhesive. Only thing is that you have to choose that color which is insoluble in water, because the reaction is taking place on water itself, on the moisture itself. So if the colorant is soluble in water, it will just wash away. Now, this technique is, as I said, it's a very easy one. It's a very common one. But in India, there is a limitation, because here, 8 out of 12 months, the average temperature is 30 degrees Celsius or more. And under these conditions, the moisture content of sweat easily evaporates. This is, you know, we are running a postgraduate diploma course in our college. And on every Saturdays and Sundays, our students go with the mobile crime team of Delhi Police. And when they bring back the report, they say that, sir, only in 5 to 10% cases are fingerprints detected. One reason, the police reaches the scene of crime late. Another reason, that the moisture content evaporates. In the month of June, temperature can be as high as 42 or 43 degrees centigrade, and the moisture content evaporates. So we thought we have to do something about it. And we asked, another thing, that these police personnel, they are of the rank of head constable or at the most assistant sub-inspector. They don't understand chemistry. They don't understand science. And they use the kit randomly. They'll take out one bottle. You know, there are a number of compositions, but each one of them is surface specific. For glass, you have to use one composition. For wood, you have to use another composition. For plastic, you have to use another composition. And unfortunately, these people are not trained. And the kit which they have is actually an imported one. So about 80,000 to 1 lakh rupees almost goes down to drain. At the most 10%, in 10% cases, they are able to detect fingerprints. This is another conventional method, ninhydrin method. This is certainly a better method. Ninhydrin is an organic compound, and it reacts with the protein contents of sweat and gives a purple colored compound called Ruhlmann's purple. Purple is the color, and Ruhlmann was the scientist who first of all did this reaction. Of course, there are certain limitations of this method also, but otherwise it was considered to be a very perfect method. It was a very trustful method. And this was the method which was used in the kidnapping case of the Tennessee girl. But when that girl's fingerprints were not there, could not be retrieved, suddenly, you know, that trust was lost. The person who was sitting to her right, his fingerprints could be retrieved. The person who was sitting to her left, even his fingerprints could be developed. The driver's fingerprints could be developed, but the child's fingerprints were nowhere in the car, neither on seat, nor on handle, nor on the door. So after this, the Federal Bureau of Investigation studied the whole matter from scratch, because everyone was rather surprised. This was considered to be a very perfect method of fingerprint detection. Why did it fail in the case of that child? And something very interesting came to light. You all know that proteins are polymers of amino acids. That polymer chain, which FBI found, is long in adult and small in children. Another way of saying the same thing is that the chain grows with age. Now, those of you who are chemistry students, they must be knowing that the size of the molecule has got profound influence on the physical and chemical properties of the substance. As the size increases, van der Waal forces of attraction increase. And as van der Waal forces of attraction increase, or for that matter, any type of attraction increases, whether it is ionic or covalent or hydrogen bonding or metal bonding, the substance transitions from gaseous state to the liquid state and from liquid state to the solid state. After all, what is the difference between the solid, liquid, and gas? In gases, the forces of attraction are very less. In liquids, they are moderate. In solids, they are very high. So, as the size of the chain increases, the melting point increases, the boiling point increases, but the volatility decreases. That means if I touch my finger on any surface, maybe after a month, a fingerprint expert may come, spray ninhydrin and retrieve my fingerprints. But for you students, maybe your protein content lasts there only for 15 days because your chain is smaller than mine. The boiling point of your protein content is less than mine. So that's going to evaporate soon. And that girl was only 7 years old. And by the time ninhydrin was sprayed, the protein content of her sweat had already evaporated. Now this, as I said, was a very interesting discovery, but it was also a very alarming discovery. Because if the nature itself destroys a piece of evidence, naturally the criminals will feel more emboldened. So something had to be done about it. At that time, a report came from Scotland Yard. It was a hypothesis which said that if you prepare a powder from nanoparticles, very small particles, having a diameter of 10 to the power minus 9 meter, then even if a meager amount of organic compounds or moisture is left, it can still soak up and develop fingerprints. This was somebody's idea. Every research starts from an idea, from a hypothesis. Later on, you can verify it by doing the experiment. So on the basis of this idea, we started developing nanoparticle size powders of fingerprints. And we were the first one to do so in India. What we did, we took nanoparticles of alumina, Al2O3. Once again, I would like to remind you that you have to take only those chemicals which are insoluble in water. And alumina is insoluble in water. We coated it with two substances. One was the hydrophobic extract of bean seed powder. The farmers call it gawar ki phali. It has got polysaccharides in it. The gum also has polysaccharides in it. When you paste two papers with gum, the interlocking is brought about by polysaccharides. So the idea was that wherever we'll spray this powder, there they will stick to the sweat constituents. And the second chemical, which we use as an ingredient, was a fluorescent dye crystal violet. Fluorescent means that if you make the room dark and if you use a light source, especially ultraviolet light, then the fingerprint starts, that chemical will start shining. Jaise andhere mein jaap karne wali mala hoti hai. You know, when we do the experiment in the laboratory, we very diligently put the fingerprint on surface, maybe paper, maybe glass, maybe plastic, and then we try to test our chemical. But at the crime scene, the situation is never so ideal. A suspect will touch each and every object very casually, except for those which he wants to carry away. So the fingerprints which we get at the crime scene, they are faint, they are fragmented. We call them chance fingerprints, ki by chance aa gaye. But if some fluorescent ingredient is there, even if they are faint, even if they are fragmented, we can make the room dark, we can impinge ultraviolet light, and they will start shining. And you can see over here, you know, this one composition had broad spectrum applications. It worked on n number of surfaces, maybe paper, glass, fiber, polished wood, polythene, plastic, and so on. And to show you the examples, it works on metal, it works on paper, and under fluorescent conditions, it shows yellowish green fluorescence. It becomes more sharp. In technical language, we say that fingerprint has become enhanced under fluorescent conditions. So that was one innovation of ours. But even this had a limitation, that it did not work on despoiled crime scenes. You see, these days, even the criminals are educated. And they are well aware that they'll be caught on the basis of fingerprint evidence. So they endeavor to eliminate their fingerprints before leaving the scene of crime. And this is not at all difficult. You commit a crime, spray water on the crime scene. The fingerprints will get washed away. Commit a crime and set the room on fire. The fingerprints will get charred. Stab somebody, bury the weapon under the earth, under soil. Even if the police comes to know where the weapon is, when they dig it out, they'll have to wash it because, you know, sludge and everything will be sticking to it. And once you wash it, the fingerprints will also get washed away. So what we thought was that as chemists, can we overcome these? There was already a method. It's called small particle reagent method, which works on moist surfaces. Only on moist surfaces, not on those which have been lifted from arson scenes. And the base material was, which is used in this technique, it's called molybdenum or molybdenum disulfide. It's dark gray in color. And if the surface itself is dark, there is always a lack of contrast. Secondly, this is very costly and a toxic reagent. And basically, you know, this is not fluorescent also. So if the fingerprints are weak, if they're fragmented, we cannot enhance them. We can enhance them only if there is, you know, if there is a fluorescent dye. And you can't choose a fluorescent dye because the color of the base material itself is very dark. We try to modify this method so that it can have multifarious applications. We took the base material instead of molybdenum disulfide, we took boron nitride. This is absolutely a non-toxic material. It's used in cosmetics. The sheen of lipsticks and nail polishes is because of boron nitride. So obviously, you know, it's a totally safe reagent to use. And it is white in color. So that means we can mix a fluorescent dye with it. We can mix a light color dye. We can mix a dark color dye. If the surface is dark, we'll use a lighter dye. If the surface is light, we'll use a dark color. So based on this, we modified the small particle reagent. And what we noticed was that this method works on those crime scene evidence which have been accidentally or deliberately bitten, which have been buried under soil, which have been buried under ice or snow, and which have been removed from arson sites. Apart from that, it worked very well on the dry objects also. Those evidence which are lifted from conventional crime scenes. And look at, you know, the types of surfaces. Just one composition, it can detect fingerprints on metals, on plastic, on tiles, on glass and crockery. As I told you, those policemen, head constable or ASI, they were using the fingerprint bottles of compositions randomly. Now here they don't have to apply their mind. There is only one composition and it works virtually on all surfaces in conventional crime scenes as well as those lifted from the despoiled crime scenes. We prepared the working solution in water. In presence of a little detergent, I have taken two representative examples. Basic yellow 40 dye, it's yellow in color. So if the surface is black or navy blue, we can use this dye. Or if it is white or it is slightly yellowish, we can use brilliant blue G. Both of them are non-toxic dyes. Both of them are fluorescent dyes. We mix them, we allow them for 15 to 20 minutes, and then the solution is ready. The shelf life of the solution is more than 6 weeks. If the crime scene evidence is small, we can spray it. If it is large, we can dip it for 1 minute. After that, we can wash it under gentle stream of water. If we want fluorescent results, we have to impinge it with light source of 505 to 550 nm. See, this is in visible range, not even in ultraviolet range. And we see yellowish fluorescence. To show you the results, this aluminium foil, it has become crumbled, no doubt, but it was, you know, submerged underwater 2 hours, 48 hours, and even 118 hours. And you can see the fingerprints are absolutely clear and sharp. This was buried under ice, taken out, washed under a gentle stream of water, and then we applied the small particle reagent, and the fingerprint is again very clear. This lamination sheet was buried under wet soil for 10 hours, again dug out, and washed under a gentle stream of water, and the SPR solution was sprayed. Then these have been lifted from arson sites, of course, mock arson sites, ceramic tiles, heated to 200, 230, 260 degrees centigrade. We are going to go further now. This experiment is not yet complete. First, they were exposed to heat, and then they were sprayed with water. The reason is that at the arson sites, the fire brigade personnel always reach first. The forensic scientist reaches later. And the fire brigade persons, you know, they are not supposed to preserve the evidence. They will randomly spray water. So we did the same thing. Imitating the actual crime scenes. And after that, we applied the small particle reagent, and you can see this crime scene evidence has been exposed both to heat as well as to water. And even after that, up to 260 degrees Celsius is giving us the fingerprints. Then these are conventional crime scene evidence from glass on glassy paper. This was our second innovation. And the third one, we call it phase transfer catalysis method. Now here, you know, there is something very innovative over here, that when we touch our finger with any surface, we leave behind dozens of chemicals. Sodium remains sodium. Potassium remains as potassium. Amino acids remain as amino acids. Proteins remain as protein. But in our sweat, we have got both magnesium and calcium ions. They immediately react with air, and they are converted into insoluble oxides and carbonates. And once they become insoluble, they will not react with anything. Now the question is that when there are so many other chemicals, why are we running after magnesium and calcium? Simply because, in general, insoluble inorganic salts are more stable as compared to soluble salts. The whitewash in your house is nothing but an insoluble salt of calcium. And if one doesn't tamper with it, nothing happens to it even after 10 years. So the idea was that if somehow we are able to tag these insoluble ions and develop fingerprints by virtue of them, then even if the police reaches the scene of crime late, they can still hope to develop the fingerprints. Because, you know, nothing will happen to insoluble salts. But the question is how to tag them. So when we were doing this research about 20 years ago, a new chemical came into being. We call it phase transfer catalyst. If you want to do a reaction catalyst, you all understand what a catalyst is. Anything which speeds up the reaction. A phase transfer catalyst is one which will bring liaison between two reactants which are in different states of matter. If I take a solution of rose bengal, this was my colorant, and I add calcium chloride to it, I get purple coloration. So as a fingerprint expert, I'm tempted that my sweat also has got calcium. If I'll spray rose bengal on the latent fingerprint, I can develop it. But then nothing happens. Why? Because calcium has been converted into insoluble calcium oxide, and now it will not react. But when I add it in concert with phase transfer catalyst, it can bring a liaison between insoluble calcium oxide and the fingerprint reagent, that is rose bengal in this case. So this was, you know, something very innovative. Phase transfer catalyst was being used in organic synthesis, but this is the first application of phase transfer catalyst in forensic science to develop fingerprints, making use of calcium. People had been trying to tag calcium for past 50 years, but it was, you know, the phase transfer catalyst which solved the problem. It's a very broad term. There are many phase transfer catalysts. We use tertiary tetrabutyl ammonium iodide. There are many other analytical reagents, but we use Rose Bengal because this was giving the best results. Now, once again, this had broad spectrum applications. We can use it on paper. It's absorbent means anything which absorbs water, paper or wood or cardboard. Non-absorbent, which doesn't absorb water, glass, metal, and lamination, and semi-absorbent, which can partially absorb water. So you see, this is one composition which works on just all surfaces. You can imagine thermocol is such a, you know, rough surface, but even on it, the fingerprints, we can possibly develop the fingerprints. These are the examples on photocopy paper, on glossy paper, absorbent, then on lamination sheet, aluminium foil and glass, on sellotape. This is important, you know. Previously, nobody experimented on tapes, and nobody thought that it can be a crime scene evidence. Now, suddenly, we feel the need of it. Almost every day you read in newspapers that somebody's pig has been stolen. And those who commit such crimes, they manipulate the digits on the number plate with the help of black electrical tape. It's very easy to convert 1 into 7, P into B, 6 into 8. And the policeman who's standing at the crossing, he'll allow the vehicle to pass. But whenever that vehicle is impounded, those small strips of tapes, which they have pasted with their own hands, they carry their fingerprints. So if you can develop those fingerprints, now the culprit cannot deny that he or she did not steal the vehicle. This method, phase transfer method, can lift fingerprints on virtually all types of surfaces, all types of tapes, sellotape, doctor's tape, packaging tape. But again, the main contribution, this is a special type of tape called duct tape. It is this tape which is used by suicide bombers to tie explosives on their bodies. From forensic point of view, no method was available to detect fingerprints on duct tape. This particular role was given to the Australian Federal Police. They said that we are actually fed up now. Please try your phase transfer catalyst method on duct tape. We had to change the composition a little bit, but finally we were able to get the prints. And we were very lucky in one respect, that we could do this project in a record time. Actually, whenever we innovate some new fingerprint composition, a lot of time goes into what we call age studies. Suppose I prepare a composition today, I'll call my students, I'll take their latent impressions on paper, on plastic, on glass. I'll put the date on the backside. Then after 2 days, I'll test whether my composition works on 2 days old fingerprints or not. Then 4 days, 1 week, 2 weeks, 1 month, 2 months. The longer I can go, the better my composition. But you know, it's time consuming also. In this case, age studies were not required. A terrorist will tie explosives on his body less than an hour before he is to strike. And the police will reach the scene of crime less than an hour after he has struck. So the fingerprints will be as good as fresh ones. We did not have to go for age studies. We just wanted to know whether the fingerprint detection works or it doesn't work. And fortunately, it did work. But as I said, with a little change in composition. This is on semi-porous surfaces, thermocol and polythene. And on compact discs, of course, nobody uses CDs now, but at that time it was very important. Because the conventional methods, they would develop fingerprints on CDs, but they would also spoil the stored data. In this case, what we noticed was that they work very well on CDs. After that, you take their picture, you rub the fingerprints with moist cotton, you put the CD back into your system, you can retrieve the entire data. And if it is a rewritable CD, you can put more files also. Once again, it works on crime scene evidence, which has been lifted from arson sites. It also works on crime scene evidence, which has remained submerged underwater. Another method which we modified, it's a very simple method. It was already there, iodine fuming method. Iodine is a sublimable solid. That means it goes directly from solid state to the vapor state. So it's simple in the sense that you take a jar, put a few crystals of iodine, put your crime scene evidence and close it with lid. Iodine on its own will evaporate and will stick to the lid and fingerprint, giving brown colored impressions. But after some times, iodine will evaporate from there also, and the fingerprint will vanish. It'll fade out. You have only 5 minutes at your disposal. So you have to keep your cameras ready. Within 5 minutes, I'm sure you can take 10 shots from different angles. And most of the times, the court of law, it gives credit to photographs. But sometimes the case is very sensational, and the honorable judge says that I want to see the original fingerprints. But that is not possible in this case, because the original fingerprints remain there for five minutes, at the most for 10 minutes. So what we thought as chemists was that all the organic compounds of iodine are brown in color. Not inorganic compounds, potassium iodide is white in color, but right from iodobenzene to iodonephthalene, each and every organic compound of iodine is brown or reddish brown in color. So if we can think of some sublimable organic compound which sublimes like iodine, we give one stream of that compound, one stream of iodine, let them react over the fingerprint, over the latent fingerprint. We knew the color will come. Only thing is, which organic sublimable compound we should select. Two most common are naphthalene and camphor. But naphthalene is slightly toxic. So we took camphor, and this is a very old reaction. Nobody thought of using it in fingerprint science. It gives 2-iodocamphor, which is brown in color. This is fingerprint of the watch glass. We have preserved it for last 2.5 years. Nothing has happened to it. First, we gave a stream of camphor. Then we gave a stream of iodine. The two reacted, and the brown colored fingerprint is before you. People have been using iodine method for past 50 years. They confess that it's a very simple method, but they also crib that the prints are not permanent. And see, a little chemistry, a small reaction, and such a big, problem has been solved. Now the prints are permanent. All you have to do is give a treatment with camphor. It works with the naphthalene also. Again, gives brown colored fingerprints. We have tested that also, but we don't highlight it because naphthalene is camphor. And naphthalene is, toxic. Camphor is totally non-toxic. Well, I'll like to go a little further. Many a times it happens that a victim is stabbed by the suspect. The suspect's fingerprints are there on the handle of the knife. But by the time the police reaches the scene of crime, the blood trickles down from the blade of the handle and covers a blade and covers the handle. Again, the fingerprints are very much there, but they have become covered beneath a layer of blood. How to retrieve them? You see, once we can take this knife, we can bake it in an oven at about 80 degrees centigrade. Most of the organic constituents of sweat will decompose, except one, which is very stable, and that is DNA. And DNA is stable because it's a polymer, and it has got a double helix structure. There is a group of compounds, we call them intercalating compounds, which become exactly fit into the double helix structure of DNA. Acridine orange is one such compound. It's a question of molecular size. The size has to be such that it exactly fits into the double helix structure. If the size is large, it will not go into that cavity. If the size is small, it will certainly go into the cavity but come out from the other side. But acridine orange is one such reagent which we have used, and it exactly fits into the double helix structure of the DNA. So what you have to do is, you bake the knife, let all the other organic compounds decompose, spray acridine orange, it will fit into the cavities of DNA, and it will give you orange colored fingerprints. But yes, this thing cannot be done at the scene of crime. You have to take the exhibit to your laboratory and do it. And that is always the wise thing to do. At the scene of crime, there is too much chaos. There is no one to help you out over there. But somehow, you know, I don't know what's the reason behind it, that the fingerprint examiners, they try to get, you know, rid of the scene of crime exhibit there and there at the scene of crime. One should never do it. Every exhibit cannot be carried to the lab, but a knife can certainly be carried. And there you have got, you know, journals, you have got your library, you have got friends, you have got literature, you have got colleagues. They are there to help you, especially if it's a blood fingerprint. Now, I quote an example. This was a very sensational case. Anju Ilyasi, her husband Suhaib, he used to present a very famous serial, India's Most Wanted. They had a tiff between them. And then Anju was found stabbed. The police personnel was standing outside their house. Nobody went in. Nobody went out. And the handle of the knife would have told the entire story. And this leaves out only two possibilities. Either Anju stabbed herself or the husband stabbed her. It was either a suicide or a murder. And the handle of the knife would have told the entire story. The handle was covered with blood. But the fingerprint examiner who went to the scene of crime, he used ordinary powder composition. Everything got messed up. And the case lingered on for almost 15 years. It's only very recently that Suhaib has been punished. So, you know, one has to be very careful. And let me give you a good example. This was, I confess, a very bad example of fingerprint detection. What you see over here, an old couple, Mr. and Mrs. Farrows, they had a departmental store over here in London. And they used to reside on the first floor of that store. The store had its headquarters somewhere else. On Monday, a manager would come from the headquarters and settle the accounts with them. So on Monday night, they had very cash with them. On Tuesdays, they have more. On Wednesdays, still more. And on Sunday, they had a lot of pounds in their cash box. They were old couple living alone, two of them. And these two ruffians were their neighbors, Alfred and Albert Stratton. They knew that the old couple was very rich on Sundays. So one Sunday in 1907, they attacked them. They killed both of them. They opened their cash box, took out the money, and then threw the cash box in air. But by that time, their hands were literally covered with blood. And they left a fingerprint which was partially coated with blood. I repeat, partially coated. Next day, a team of policemen headed by Charles Collin, detective superintendent, roughly equivalent to the inspector general of police in our country, they reached the scene of crime. His team saw that cash box. And they said, sir, it's partially covered with blood. Should we develop it? Collin said, no. Put it in the polythene and take it to my laboratory. And there he developed the fingerprints. Again, I repeat, that was the most wise thing to do. There was no technique at that time to develop bloody fingerprints. But half the fingerprint was okay. You know, it was normal fingerprint. And I told you in the beginning that even if the fingerprint is partial, you can still get a few fingerprint characters. You can still identify the person. So he was able to develop the fingerprints. But at that time, there was another problem. And that was that the science of fingerprinting was in its infancy. Many people, many scientists, including the judges, they were not aware of the importance of fingerprints. I again repeat, in Scotland Yard, the world's second fingerprint was established in 1904, and this case is also of 1904. So when the case goes to the court, one full day was assigned to Collins to explain it to his honor, the importance of fingerprints. He started very well. How the fingerprints are formed, what's the role of sweat, what's the role of fingerprint composition, how they are detected, how they are compared. But at the end of the day, he noticed that his lordship was not getting properly convinced. So he asked for more time the next day. That night, Collins sat through in his laboratory and he prepared two big pictures of fingerprints, two big frames. Please appreciate, in those times, there was no computer, there was no printer, even the cameras, the photographic techniques were also not up to the mark as it is today. But next day when he entered the court, he had those two big frames in his hands. He kept them side by side and told Honorable Judge that, sir, this one belongs to the accused and this one I got from the cash box. Point by point, character by character, he matched them. See the zeal, see the enthusiasm, and see also the result. 56 days after the murder of Mr. and Mrs. Farrows, just 56 days later, both Alfred and Albert Stratton were hanged to death. Just 56 days later. Something which could have been done in case of Soheib Ilyasi also. But since the case went on for 15 years, obviously after 15 years, nobody will say that this convict should be hanged. He has already served the tenure of life in prison. You can't give two punishments to one person for one crime. Well, I end there, but there's a small, something light over here. Returning to the case, Alfred and Albert were twin brothers. The court ordered them to hang on the same day at the same time. So the jail authorities had to requisition two hangmen. And incidentally, they were also twin brothers. So I think in today's talk, that's all I have to say. I'll be glad if you have any questions and I'll try to answer them.
Thank you so much, Sodhi sir, for this informative session. And definitely we can take questions from the participants. So participants, if you have any question, you can either write in the chat box or if you want to ask it in person, you can just raise your hand. I'll allow you to ask the questions.
Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful talk. There is one question from Professor Akhilesh, sir. The question is, he wants to know that, can we lift fingerprint from the skin of a disease? And if yes, then how, as it can be imported in cases of manual strangulation?
See, it's a very, very interesting and a very important question. People have done certain experiments with iodine fuming. They have been able to do it. With cyanoacrylate fuming also, they have been able to do it. But as far as I am aware, no real case has been solved. This is actually a very big lacuna. You know, in cases of rape, in cases of assault, you get fingerprints either on garments or on the skin. And both of them, you know, they are critical gap areas. People have claimed that they could lift the fingerprints on garments and on skin. But again, I repeat, no actual case has been solved. They only, these techniques work only in the laboratory, not in the real cases.
Yes, sir, I completely agree with you. So any other question from any participant?
Yes, sir. We have one question from Asa Verma. That is that, sir, we can distinguish or individualize the person when we get mixed fingerprints.
Yes, you know, earlier this was a problem. You know, suppose somebody is using a knife for some peaceful purpose, cutting vegetables and all that, and later on another person comes and, you know, stabs the victim with the same knife, there will be overlapping of fingerprints. So you can take, you can develop them, you can take the photograph, and there are, you know, apps on Adobe by which you can separate them out. It's not at all difficult. You can separate them out.
Okay, so there's one more question from Dhruv Shyam Vimal. I want to ask that, can we have fingerprints from a metal object immersed in water or buried in soil for 50 years?
Well, you see, nobody have tried that. 50 years is a very long period. I'm afraid it may not work. But since, you know, these techniques are coming out very recently, it's too early to say whether after 50 years we'll be able to do it or not. I'm not at all sure. As far as the ninhydrin technique is concerned, it can give fingerprints as old as 15 to 20 years. But not on buried items, not on submerged items, on ordinary conventional scenes, crime scene evidence.
Okay, so someone has raised a hand. Let me allow him to...
You can speak out. He or she can unmute and speak out.
Yes, sir. I'll do that. Isha, you will be able to speak now. Please ask
your question. Good afternoon.
Yes, good afternoon. Hello.
My question is, you said fingerprints, multiple fingerprints on a particular object from different sources can be separated. How can it be separated? What kind of apps can be used to separate it? Example of the app.
Can you kindly repeat what kind of?
I said, what kind of app, or how can we separate these fingerprints, or what kind of app can be used to separate these multiple fingerprints?
No. You first have to develop them. You have to take the photographs, put them in Adobe. And then you can separate them.
Okay.
Adobe will do the work for you.
Adobe.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So when we have one more question from Neha Jan, that is, in case of explosion, any particular method or for lifting or collection of the fingerprint?
Yeah, you see, as I told you, in case of explosion, the phase transfer method works. That's why we use it for duct tape, because it can sustain high temperature, and it can sustain the explosive stress also. And even then, the method works. So this is one method which we have tried out, phase transfer method, and it actually works on in explosive cases. In case of explosion.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. There is one more question from Dr. Sonal, that is there any particular choice of material of particular crime scene, drowning, explosion, strangulation, etc.?
Choice of evidence for?
Particular crime scene.
No, I can't follow that.
I guess, Dr. Sonal, I'll request you if you could just unmute yourself and ask the question.
Please do that.
Dr. Sonal?
Yes, good evening.
Good evening.
Sir, thank you for the wonderful session. Actually, I wanted to ask, to collect the fingerprint or to reciprocate, like, usko agar karna hai, then what can be the particular choice of material for different crime scenes? Like, as it just now you told about the explosion. So in the strangulation or in droning, so any particular choice of material as per your opinion or your suggestion?
When you know, a crime scene investigator goes to the crime scene, he should collect as much evidence as possible. Okay. You do not know, you know, on one particular evidence, there will be fingerprints or not, because they are latent. You can't see them over there. And even if they are there, whether he or she will be able to develop it in the lab or not. So the best thing is that you should collect virtually all the evidence which are before you. And then you try them one by one.
All right, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Then, sir, we have one question from Ruchika. She is asking for some suggestion for future research work in the fingerprint examination.
Well, research in fingerprint, she wants to join some university or something like that.
I guess Ruchika is asking for that. What are the area could be for further research in the fingerprint examination, sir?
She wants to do some research work over
yes.
here.
Yes, yes, huh? I guess so. Yes,
she can join internship in any of the forensic labs. I think Dr. Ranjit could also be able to take her. These days the colleges unfortunately are closed because of lockdown. We are taking online classes. Otherwise, every summer vacations, a lot of students used to come to me, especially for fingerprint research. And once, you know, the things are normal, she can apply to my college. I'll take her.
Okay, sir. I hope, Ruchika, you got your answer. There's one more question, sir, from Sri Lakshmi that, how about the overlap fingerprints? I guess she wants to know that how we can identify if we having the overlap fingerprints.
See, that's what I was telling you. You have to go to the Adobe and then separate them out.
Yes. Then, sir, we have one more question from Arpit Gupta that can we see the fingerprint from thermal cam or using infrared photography?
Thermal paper, thermal?
Thermal cam. I guess.
Dobara se bologe? Ek bari aage thermal ke aage kya hai?
It's cam, CAM, sir.
Thermal camera.
Yeah, I guess he want to write thermal camera only.
You see, as far as camera is concerned, what type of materials? Either polymeric or glass lenses. Yes, we can do it. No problem at all. We can do it.
Okay. Then we have another question from Dr. Akhilesh that can we use non-toxic material like turmeric to develop fingerprint?
Yes. People have been using it, and this type of research is going on in Punjabi University. They have used even some spices. Turmeric is also there. But you see, the problem is that, as I said, you can prepare a powder. You can certainly prepare a powder. You mix up chalk and turmeric, you will get fingerprints, but only fresh fingerprints. See, that's the problem, because in our country, the temperature is so high. So the type of indigenous compositions, they work for very few hours. Even 2 days old fingerprints will not be able to lift, unless and until you use very hi-fi sort of chemicals. Turmeric can work. I repeat, it's very simple. You can take talcum powder and turmeric. You can take chalk powder and turmeric. But the duration of the time lag will be only a few hours. After that, the fingerprints will not be able to be retrieved.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir, for the answer. One question we have, one more question from Abbey. He wants to ask that when it comes to collection of evidences from scene of crime, for example, or explosion scene, if possibly crime scene officer collect hand grenades, like hand grenade pen is there. So will fingerprints be collected from such evidence?
Yes, yes, you can. You can.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. So do we have any more questions?
I think Afreen, we have taken a number of questions. Yes, so sir. Due to the time constraints, sir is also having a time. So thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful talk. And if you just see the chat box, you can see the lots of questions going through. So I'll request you all, if you can put these questions into the feedback or email us, we'll share this with the sir, and sir will send you the answer. Right, sir? Afreen?
Yes, sir.
Sir is in the room.
I guess, sir, he lost the connection. Sir is in the session now.
I think this is one of the best sessions we all have attended. We used to organize lots of sessions on every Sunday. So thank you so much. I request Afreen to give the closing remark about the session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ranjit, sir, for giving me this opportunity. And thank you, Sodhi, sir, for delivering such an amazing session. I can definitely say that those who have heard the session, they must definitely have learned about the things. They must definitely have got to know something new about this in fingerprint. So thank you so much, sir, for sharing your knowledge and telling us that what could be more done in this particular field of the fingerprint. So that's all from my side, sir. And I'd like to present you the small token of appreciation. That is to you, sir, for delivering this expert talk on advances in chemical development or latent fingerprint, sir. We request you to kindly accept the same, sir. So with the permission of Sodhi, sir, and Ranjit, sir, am I allowed to end the session for the day?
Yes, please do. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.